Okay, so we now move on to Holger Baumgart, and just make him the presenter of the. Let's see if I can successfully do that. Let's see if he now make a presenter. Okay, now he's our presenter. And you can then share the screen if kindly turn on your video and yes, okay, it's coming up. Yes, we have the presentation. We need the sound and the video in order to start this. Let's see how this goes. Okay, let's see. May I Olga to turn on the video as well as turning on the microphone? There's no technical issue there. Something is happening as I can see. So the next talk is going to be on global clusters and moons. We learn about them from Gaia. Or the title, as you see on this screen. We still don't have the video, and we still don't have the sound. I hope our technical people can just check. There is anything to be done.
Holger, sorry, Harry, may I enter?
Yeah, go on, go on.
Holger, I think you should turn on your microphone if you hear me.
Did anybody hear me?
Oh, now we
Yeah,
can
no,
hear you.
it's okay.
Now we can hear you, but still.
Finally. Oh, man. Okay.
Please open the
Yeah.
video. At the bottom of the page, there is the video.
Yeah. If I managed it. Yeah, can you also see me now? I think it is coming up.
Right now. Oh, yes, it's coming up.
Yeah.
All
Okay.
right.
So now you can also see me. Okay. Good. Finally. Yeah. So thanks everybody for giving me the opportunity to talk at your meeting. And so in my talk, I would like to talk about the impact that Gaia has and will have on understanding globular clusters. Yeah. Okay. So when it comes to globular clusters, so there are a number of questions that people are interested in. Great. You can see slide one. Yeah, okay. So now it's also slide two is up. So one concerns questions about the formation of globular clusters. So we know, these objects are very old, so typically. So globular clusters really formed in the very early stages of the formation of galaxies. So therefore, understanding how they formed and when and where does actually tell us a lot also about the early evolution of galaxies. And then, I mean, another question which is closely linked to the formation is also the connection between globular clusters and galaxies. Because observationally, what one can sometimes see is that, I mean, some globular clusters in the Milky Way, like Omega Sen or M54, for example, these are actually not globular clusters. So these are actually nuclei of dwarf galaxies. And therefore, that again brings up a whole number of new questions. So first, how has the galaxy environment influenced the formation of a globular cluster? If a globular cluster sits in the center of a galaxy, then you can imagine that you have gas falling into that globular cluster multiple times. And therefore, you will get different stellar populations in a globular cluster. And also, we know, of course, that observationally, galaxies do contain massive black holes. And so therefore, the question is, could there also be some globular clusters which do contain massive black holes in their centers? Yeah, and then, I mean, finally, when you look at a globular cluster has a very high density. So the typical density in the centers of globular clusters can go up to 10 to the 5. So sometimes even 10 to the 7 solar masses per cubic parsec. And so that encounters between stars in the center of a globular cluster are very common. And I mean, that leads to the formation of exotic stars in a globular cluster. So that the Milky Way, or that in the Milky Way, there are about 200 millisecond pulsars known, and more than half of these are in globular clusters. And that despite the fact that when you look among ordinary stars, there's less than 0.1% of all stars is in globular clusters. And I mean, that also holds, for example, when you're watching black holes, which can now be seen with gravitational wave instruments. So again, globular clusters are very efficient for that, and people are interested in understanding, so how many of these objects are actually being formed in globular clusters, and which type of objects do you form? Yeah, so there are lots of interesting questions to study. So how will Gaia help us with these? Well, so I mean, Gaia is intended to measure the motion, so the proper motions and parallaxes of about 1 billion stars in the Milky Way, so down to about 20th magnitude. And in addition to that, Gaia is also going to measure radial velocities for a few tens, maybe 100 million stars, and also photometry and stellar parameters. And I mean, that one can really expect is going to bring a wealth of new information about globular clusters. And I mean, just to show you what impact Gaia is likely going to have, I show here on the right-hand side a typical a color magnitude diagram of a nearby cluster, so that is 47 Tucanae. And I mean, here you can see different limits to what Gaia will achieve with a given accuracy. So for example, the radial velocity is shown here in blue. So the limit down to which Gaia can measure radial velocities is something like 17th magnitude. So that means Gaia will be able to measure radial velocities for almost all stars on the red giant branch in the globular cluster. And so that is for a big globular cluster, there's already going to be thousands of stars. And I mean, in terms of proper motions, Gaia is doing even better towards main sequence stars and measure their motion in the globular cluster. So there is really going to be a wealth of new information which Gaia is going to bring us. But when I show that, I mean, so this is the expected end of mission performance, so we only will get this performance in a couple of years. But I mean, nevertheless, I mean, in 2018, Gaia released already its second data release, and I mean, that already contained proper motions for 1 billion stars, just with not quite that large accuracy. Yeah, okay, and so what have we learned from this data that Gaia has given us? So, I mean, one thing that we now have are actually, we do have the orbits of basically almost every globular cluster in the Milky Way. So, I mean, in the pre-Gaia era, I mean, only a few dozen globular clusters had measured orbits, so they had proper motion measures. And I mean, these orbits were often influenced by very large systematic errors. So you could not really trust the orbits. But I mean, nowadays, we do have good orbits for almost all globular clusters. And I mean, these orbits already give us a very good information on how the clusters formed. And so you can see an example here. So that is the globular cluster Paloma 10. And okay, I mean, there you can...
Okay, may I interrupt you for a second?
Yeah.
It seems that some of our viewers have a slow internet. So we might want to ask you to turn off your camera while you're presenting.
Okay.
And we will
okay, yeah.
Back again. Okay, thank yeah. you very much. Thank you.
Okay, so camera is off now. So hopefully it works better now. So I mean, what you can see here is the orbit of the global cluster Paloma 10. So you can see orbit in the XY plane, so from above here on the left hand side, and orbit in the Z and R plane here on the right hand side. And I mean, you can see immediately that this global cluster is basically moving in the disk of the Milky Way. So it does not make very strong excursion out of the plane. And that already tells you that probably the formation of this cluster was really closely linked to the formation of the disk of the Milky Way. And so, I mean, that is something that people have done. So they have basically used the orbital characteristics of globular clusters, which we get from Gaia, to basically understand what different kinds of groups one has in the Milky Way, and how are these linked to the formation of the Milky Way itself. And so that is also something that you can see in this plot here. So, I mean, this plot basically shows for all non-globular clusters their position in a diagram which has the energy of the cluster on one axis and the angular momentum of the cluster on the other axis. And there, I mean, one can see that, I mean, globular clusters really do fall into different groups. So there is first the so-called old halo group. So these are clusters close to the center of the Milky Way, which are very old, very early. Then there's the young halo group. So these are clusters more further out in the Milky Way. So I mean, one clearly sees here, there's a time sequence of events. So the clusters close to the center of the Milky Way form first, and then star formation propagated outwards in the early times. And I mean, they have also identified different subgroups among the globular cluster population. So there is, for example, the group of Sagittarius globular clusters. So these are clusters which are Sagittarius dwarf galaxies, shown by black squares here. There's also the so-called sausage clusters, which are globular clusters which belong to another dwarf galaxy, which has merged with the early Milky Way, but is now completely dissolved. Yeah, and so hopefully the slide comes up. So people have basically split up or identified different groups of globular clusters, and each of these was or is related to a dwarf galaxy that merged with the early Milky Way. And so I mean here, that is so one distinction by Kruisnet al. So they identified three main dwarf galaxies which merged. So that is Kraken, Gaia Enceladus, and Sagittarius. And then also a number of. So I mean, here Gaia and the globular clusters that are measured by Gaia really give us information on how the Milky Way as a whole galaxy. And I mean, that becomes even more interesting when one also combines the information that Gaia gives us. So I mean, basically the orbital information, also with the ages of the globular clusters and their metallicities. And so that is again a plot from Kruisnet al. So what is shown here is basically here in left, these are on the left hand side, these are all the globular clusters which are identified with the Kraken dwarf galaxies. And here on the right hand side, these are the globular clusters identified with Gaia Enceladus. And so what one can see is that, I mean, as the clusters get younger and younger, so is also their metallicity increasing. So one can see how the chemical enrichment in that dwarf galaxy, even though it has already been dissolved a long time ago, how that chemical enrichment has happened. And so one sees this clear increase of metallicity with age in both of these dwarf galaxies. And this enrichment is also, when you compare it with the globular clusters which belong to the Milky Way itself, so were not brought in by a dwarf galaxy, so these are shown by black dots here. So, I mean, this the Milky Way itself, that formed in a much higher density environment, and therefore the chemical enrichment also happened much faster. So at a given age, the in-situ globular clusters have a much higher metallicity compared to both globular clusters which were brought in by dwarf galaxies. So, I mean, here one gets really a wealth of information from Gaia, which one can then also compare with cosmological simulations and see if that these correlations which one sees here are also found in these simulations. Yeah, so another thing where Gaia proper motions have been very useful is, I mean, when you look into the halo of the Milky Way, the halo of the Milky Way not only contains globular clusters, so surviving stellar systems, but there are also lots of streams which come from dissolved globular clusters. And so one of these streams is, for example, the GD1 stream. And I mean, the interesting thing here is, I mean, using the proper motions from Gaia, one can actually very nicely select all the stars which belong to this stream, even though the background density of stars is very high, but Gaia lets one pick out the members of this stream. And what one can then see is that when one looks along these streams, I mean, the density of stars is basically not constant. So instead, in these streams, one gets overdense region and also underdense regions. And I mean, one possibility for creating these over and under densities is that, I mean, the stars in the stream do have encounters with dark matter halos, which can't be seen. They don't contain any stars, but cosmology predicts them. And so that way, one can basically study the number and masses of these halos using stars in streams. Yeah, so that is also something where Gaia has been very useful. And I mean, then finally, one can also use Gaia to study the internal kinematics of star clusters or globular clusters. And so, I mean, one thing where Gaia is really very useful is actually picking out stars which do belong to globular clusters. And so that is shown in this image here. So that shows you the globular cluster FSR 1758. So here on the left-hand side, you can see an image of that globular cluster taken by DECAM. But actually, when you look at the image, you see nothing. And so the reason for that is that, I mean, that globular cluster sits in such a high density of stars that it is basically almost impossible to make out the globular cluster. The background density of stars is just far too high. But what you can do is, you go to Gaia and you look at the proper motions of all the stars which are in the field of this globular cluster, and then immediately you can pick out the globular cluster. Because, I mean, all the stars which belong to the cluster, they share the same motion. So they sit at one place in this proper motion diagram, and that place is very distinct from the background distribution of stars. So here, Gaia does allow you to immediately pick out which stars belong to the cluster. And in fact, I mean, this global cluster was only discovered after the Gaia data came out. Yeah, and then, I mean, finally, Gaia is also very useful to basically look at the internal motion of stars. And so that is shown here again for the globular cluster 47 Tucanae. So I mean that just shows you the velocity dispersion of that cluster as a function of distance. And so I mean for that, to put that together, I used different instruments. So there are MUSE observations in the very center, also HST proper motions. So they allow you to measure the motion of stars very close to the center. But I mean, both MUSE and HST have a very limited field of view. So I mean, you can only get out to something like 100 arc seconds using these instruments. But for larger distances, then I mean, the radial velocities, which Gaia is giving you, and also the proper motions of Gaia are extremely useful. So I mean, thanks to Gaia, it is basically possible for a few globular clusters to measure the velocity dispersion profile from basically something like 1 arc second or a few arc seconds to a few thousand arc seconds. So from the very center, basically all the way to the tidal radius of a global cluster. So we can get very accurate information on how stars move in a cluster. And I mean, that is really extremely useful because you can then combine this information on the kinematics with information that you get, for example, from the Hubble Space Telescope. And I hope the slide is going to come up. So HST it gives you photometry. And basically that photometry tells you how, gives you a color magnitude diagram of a globular cluster, and then you can fit an isochrone to that color magnitude diagram. And that way you get information on the masses of stars. And something that you can do is, since you can then look at what astronomers call the mass function of stars. So basically how stars at different radii in a globular cluster, how the stars are distributed over Mars. And I mean, then for many clusters, so these observations show you, for example, that clusters are mass segregated. So that all the massive stars have sunk into the center of a cluster and the low mass stars have moved to the outskirts. Yeah, and then combining so the kinematics from Gaia and ground-based observations, the photometry, so the mass functions from HST, combining that information then with in-body simulations, for example, then basically lets you develop a full model for any given globular cluster. So you understand the total mass of the cluster, the structural parameters, radii, how masses are internally distributed, and you also get some information on how that cluster has evolved over the 12 giga years of its lifetime. Yeah, and I mean, you can then use that, for example, to answer a few questions. So for example, initially I showed, I mean, so some globular clusters are thought to be centers of dwarf galaxies. So since dwarf galaxies, or since galaxies contain massive black holes, one can also assume maybe a few of these globular clusters could also contain massive black holes. But I mean, that is something which currently is hotly debated, but so far it does not look as if any globular cluster contains a massive black hole. And so you can see in here for the cluster M15, so I mean in black is shown the observed surface density profile here on the left-hand side, observed velocity dispersion here on the right-hand side, and in blue and red I show models which I've calculated, both a model which contains an intermediate mass black hole, which does not contain intermediate mass black hole, that is shown in blue, and that provides a nice fit basically to both surface density and velocity dispersion profile, and in red models an intermediate mass black hole. But I mean, these do not fit the observed surface density profile or velocity dispersion profile. So, I mean, therefore, one can basically exclude the presence of such an intermediate mass black hole, a few thousand solar mass black hole, not only in this globular cluster, but in basically almost all globular clusters in the Milky Way. So it seems that, I mean, globular clusters, so systems which have maybe 10 to the 5, 10 to the 6 solar masses, do not contain massive black holes. But, I mean, that is actually in quite different to the situation in so-called ultra-compact dwarf galaxies. So ultra-compact dwarf galaxies, I mean, these are stellar systems. They have the same age as globular clusters, also 10, 12 giga-years, but they have much higher masses. So UCD masses go from something like 10 to the 7th up to a few times 10 to the 8th solar masses. And I mean, so these UCDs, they have been discovered in large galaxy clusters like Virgo or Fornax. And I mean, in the previous few years, people have obtained kinematics for these UCDs, and they have found very massive black holes in these UCDs. So, I mean, we now have measurements for 5 or 6 of them, and in each of them, we have found black holes of 10 to the 6, 10 to the 7 solar masses. So it seems that nature is very effective of producing these very massive black holes in UCDs, but in globular clusters, none of these black holes form. And that is something we see in observations, but at the moment, nobody knows why. Okay, and I see already the chairman is coming up, so I don't know. I would have 2 or 3 more slides, but I could also stop here, so I don't know. Okay. And so the final topic is also something I'm interested in, and which has also been very puzzling to astronomers is, okay, I mean, so we have the kinematics. So one thing we can calculate is the mass of a globular cluster based on the kinematics, and then also the mass to light ratio. So how much mass one needs to create one unit of luminosity. And I mean, so the puzzling result that people found was that, I mean, the mass to light ratio of globular clusters, when you plot them against metallicity, the surprising thing is you do not see a variation of that mass to light ratio. So the mass to light ratio is around 1.8. And I mean, it is 1.8 for the lowest metallicity clusters, which one can see, which have metallicity below -2, and even all the way up to clusters which almost have solar metallicity. And so that was very confusing, because when one compares it with the expected mass to light ratio, I mean, from stellar evolution also, that would predict that mass to light ratios should strongly increase when you go from low metallicity to high metallicity. And so that has led some people to argue that possibly maybe there is a variation of the IMF with cluster metallicity or environment where cluster forms. But I mean, I investigated that a little bit closer. And so one thing which was not taken into account is that actually there's also systematic variation of the mass function of a cluster, of the present day mass function with metallicity. So high metallicity clusters sit closer to the center, and therefore they are more depleted in low mass stars. And once one considers this, and then compares the observed mass to light ratio with the one which one expects based on stellar evolution, then one actually finds that for all globular clusters, no matter if low or high metallicity, the expected mass to light ratios are actually very actually consistent with the ones which one sees. So that argues against any variation of the IMF with metallicity. And interestingly, if one puts in the UCDs as well, which I mentioned, they basically follow the same relation. So, I mean, observations look like an invariant IMF over, say, 4 orders of magnitude. So going from stellar systems from 10 to the 4 solar masses all the way to 10 to the 8 solar masses. Okay. Yeah. So, I mean, that's my talk. Thank you for your attention, and I'm open to questions.
Okay. Thank you very much. Might as well turn on your camera back. So
okay, I try.
The last few minutes.
Yep.
I've already put up a note for calling for questions. If there are any questions, please raise your hand. It's time to speak now. Any questions for our presenter? Silence. Well, it was very interesting talking, but it was apparently very clear.
Yeah.
Sign of any questions? Hossein, do you have any question? They hear me well. Okay, so I've got one question. One question from Mahmoud, please. Mahmoud, please turn on your microphone. Switch on your microphone and speak. Dr. Mahmoud Roshan, you've not been allowed to speak, so please kindly turn off. Yeah. Okay, please, Mahmoud Roshan, please. Turn on your microphone. If Mahmoud, do you want to just type your question instead?
Habib, if it is possible, I have a question.
Yes, please go ahead while Mahmoud is typing. Okay.
Okay. Hello, Holger. Thank you very much for your time. My question is about the correlation between slope of the mass function and the cluster concentration parameter. The Marchi relation, if you remember, and you showed that there is no correlation, I think. If the DiMarchi analysis is wrong, you think, or the new method that you use is different from them?
The problem is, most of the participants won't know what the question is about, but when you look at this plot that they had, and you split it in half, then almost all their clusters are on the left-hand side, and there is no correlation on the left-hand side in their plot. There the clusters widely scatter all over the place. When you then look at the right-hand side, there are actually only three clusters there. They are all in the lower half of the plot, but actually, one of them is wrong. So there they made a mistake. That cluster should have been up there. And since they have so few clusters, there's already enough to destroy any correlation, any significance, what they find. So I would say the problem with their analysis was too few clusters and also not 100% the best data.
Okay, very good. We have the question from Dr. Roshan, who asks, is there any contribution to the mass of the cluster from dark matter side?
That is not entirely clear. If you look at this plot here, so on my last one, there you can see so that the observed master light ratios agree with the expected ones. And here I've calculated expected ones, of course, without any dark matter. So, if there would be significant amounts of dark matter in the inner parts of a globular cluster, you would expect to see it, because then the observed master light ratio should be far higher than the expected ones. So that is not the case. But of course, the question is, what can't be ruled out is that there could be a dark matter halo in the outer parts of a globular cluster. That would always be possible. And that is not, I can't say anything about it. But of course, Gaia will be most useful for that, because Gaia is measuring the motions of stars in the outskirts of globular clusters. So if there is dark matter there, then one could maybe hope that Gaia will find it.
Okay, very good. Well, thank you very much indeed, Holger. So it was a very nice presentation, and thank you to all our audiences and the other speakers this morning. So thank you very much, and hope to see you, meet you in person.
Yeah. Okay, bye.